might be Riley Factura with all of that consistency this season. So let's get into this game number one between Riley and Justin. Riley going to be leading with the Whipsicott and the Iron Crown. And for Justin, you've got the Thunderous and Zamazenta.
Importantly, the Zamazenta, because it doesn't have the Iron Defense like you pointed out, Rose, if it switches out, it will no longer have the defense boost from the Dauntless Shield ability. It only activates once per battle now in Scarlet and Violet. So if that does leave the field and come back in, it will not have a boosted body press. But the Iron Crown and the Whimsicott on Riley's side will be looking to match the offense put out by the Thunderous and the Zamazenta. But the Thunderous here actually in a pretty good spot because Eerie Impulse, a very strong movement to two special attackers.
It is. I mean, you're gonna Hello, Maraidon. It's so useful to be able to have against this entire team. And it's going to be important to see if you can actually weave those in. Maybe force Riley to have to make some pivots he might not necessarily want to. But it's time for Terrestrialization. So just with what's on the field, that has to be the Iron Crown. With that Expert Belt, no less. So anything that's going to be super effective is going to be able to be amplified even further. And that's the Ground Terra.
And it has Terra Blast too. We could see a big Terra Blast coming through, but Eerie Impulse will lower the special attack of that Iron Crown by two stages right off the bat.
Yep, that's exactly how that works. It is an electric type attack into a ground type Pokemon. That's where I was going with that. Sorry. You know what I mean? Like, it's just funny that that's the mechanic. Right. You're using an electric type attack into a ground type Pokemon.
True. Yeah, just I think some status moves kind of bypass that type interaction. But a really impactful area impulse there, too, because that Zamazenta took less than half. And now Maraidon on Riley's side also took a big body press coming in. Of course, Thunderous cannot paralyze a Maraidon because electric types are immune to paralysis. So there's no possible speed control here, and Maraidon should be able to act first. Of course, can get Eerie Impulse. Again, as we've learned, nothing is immune to Eerie Impulse. But at the same time, you're still a Choice Specs Maraidon in electric terrain. Even a minus two, like Electro Drift or Volt Switch, might be enough to finish off the Zamazenta after that Terra Blast.
Well, the Iron Crown doesn't want to stay in the face of something like the Zamazenta, or and also you just got to shed those drops. So it's going to be the Incineroar now that takes the field. It'll lower the Zamazenta's attack and see what else it can get done. But it's time for another Terra.
It sure is. Most likely this Zamazenta, which should allow it to resist any electric type attacks coming out from this Maraidon as it turns into a grass type. Very common Terra type on Zamazenta, allows you to kind of ignore Amoongus, which is very, very helpful when you're using a Pokemon like Zamazenta. Eerie Impulse does come out here lowering minus two special attack because that is how that move works.
No, it is how that works. An electric type into an electric type. It works too, but yeah, the Volt Switch. So super nice to know that even though it is going to get Eerie Impulse, it's going to shed those drops immediately. Take a look at how well the Zamazenta did take that with that Grass Terra, as you called out.
You have to wonder if like the Eerie Impulse and Terra was a bit of overkill there. Like maybe you could have possibly preserved that Terra for later on. But at the same time, even at like a minus two, if Riley had gone for like a Terrestrialization, you can't Terrestrialize, I guess, but even like Electro Drift, a minus two, maybe was still enough. So it's just covering for all your options there, right? You're going to be able to get a body press off on this turn. If Justin opted to body press the Iron Crown, actually a really big deal here because the Incineroar did swap in. Whimsicott will take Maraidon's place, and now Zamazenta gets to act.
Zamazenta goes for the body press into the Incineroar. It's not quite enough for the one-hit knockout, but it is going to take the Incineroar down so low. Threatening Fake Out, though, on this next turn.
Does threaten Fake Out, but thankfully the Thunderous is holding that lovely Covert Cloak item, so it cannot be flinched. You do have the option to finish it off with a Thunderbolt. Your Zamazenta should be able to survive one Moonblast from Whimsicott, I would imagine. Still a pretty bulky Pokemon, and is neutral even after that Terrestrialization. And Heavy Slam, pretty big threat into Whimsicott as well. But Zamazenta, again, it's kind of one of those things, when you're not running Iron Defense, it's really nice to keep it on the field as long as possible because you will not have the option to boost your defense again afterwards.
Yeah, I think you just have to keep the Zamazenta on the field, and one of the things that it can do best is sit there.
Yeah,
but
truly.
Just keep kind of wailing away on its opponents with a body press or just a heavy slam. So it's going to eat the fake out this time around, but the Eerie Impulse into the Whimsicott is going to be able to lower that special attack for the Moonblast. So if you weren't convinced it might survive before, it might now, and this Zamazenta sure will too.
And it should survive one more too. We saw it do 22 damage with that Moonblast. which should be more than enough for Zamazenta to stick around. Fire off another big body press into that Incineroar slot if it wants, because nothing that switches in, or nothing that could switch in, would resist it at all. And I think anything that switches in also would probably get knocked out. The Iron Crown and the Maridon both pretty low, and now Ryli's options are pretty limited. Whimsicott being the only very healthy Pokemon, it's nice because you have the Focus Sash intact still, but Whimsicott, especially at minus two special attack, really not known for its offense.
No, it's not. I mean, we have seen maybe a couple big Moonblast before, but it's still a tough call. This Incineroar also maybe worth calling out that it is a four-move set. So it has the Assault Vest.
Yep.
So it does have access to Flare Blitz, Fake Out U-Turn, and Knock Off. Wondering if the U-Turn might be important here if you're trying to get that super effective damage down into the Zamazenta, but you're not going to be able to land it anyway because of that Protect. Whimsicott. Gonna go for the Tailwind, able to get this speed control up and running. And because it's just a naturally faster Pokemon, it's able to get that up before you see this taunt come through from the Thunderous.
Flare Blitz will go into the Protect of that Zamazenta, even with the defense boost at this point, would be more than enough damage. And based on how this Incineroar is trained, it's likely that it could outspeed this Zamazenta. Because it is a Dark type, you cannot paralyze it with a Prankster Thunder Wave, as Dark types are immune. So this Zamazenta now no longer in a position where it's kind of free to just go for any attack it might want. Based on how either of them are trained, it's still very possible that Zamazenta outspeeds this Incineroar. And of course, we saw the Moonblast do very little damage before. So if Incineroar is faster than Zamazenta, then Ryli's in a great spot. If it's not, then Justin has to basically just pick whatever he wants to get knocked out in that slot.
Ooh, well, the Whimsicott's going to leave the field. With its Focus Sash intact, which could be very important later on in the game, and the Iron Crown now going to take its place. It's going to get its Quark Drive activated too, so in case you missed it, it's going to be a special attack boost for the Body Press, able to finish off this Incineroar.
And importantly, Zamazenta is still outspeeding Incineroar in Tailwind. Really nice info for both of these trainers, because that could have been a big momentum swing in Ryli's favor if the Incineroar was able to act first and KO Zamazenta. Thunderbolt will fly into the ground-type Iron Crown and do no damage because it is immune. But now we are in a position where Justin has a Pokemon advantage. Not only that, has done a lot of damage to both the Iron Crown and the Maridon on Ryli's side, and hasn't even revealed his third or fourth Pokemon.
Yeah, I mean, that's just impressive, honestly.
Yeah.
This Thunderous and Zamazenta sticking around for so long and also able to secure a KO before you reveal anything else. Great timing, though, by Ryli. Waited for that electric terrain to expire and then comes back in with the Maridon to reactivate it right away.
And of course, the Tailwind is up on Ryli's side. Speed advantage is secured, and neither Pokemon on Ryli's side can be affected by Thunder Wave. Maridon being electric type and Iron Crown being a ground type, neither of which Thunder Wave can connect with. And I actually thought Iron Crown took some damage earlier on, but it is still at full health and in a pretty good position. Those Tachyon Cutters and the Psychic Noise might be able to make a big impact here thanks to that Quark Drive special attack boost.
Feels good too, because even if you do get that special attack dropped by something like an Eerie Impulse, I don't think you mind.
You don't mind,
and
like only one can be dropped at a time. Like
yeah.
Both of them are at neutral now.
Pick your poison.
You just have to pick, exactly.
So it will be a very tough one to consider, but Ryli's just going to play it safe. Wants to protect this Iron Crown for now. Oh, but it is going to be the Maridon that is the key target. So this Protect might be for nothing here if this Maridon is not able to do enough damage, because it's a Discharge. Iron Crown would have taken that anyway, because it's that ground
terror type. Oh, it survives.
And it survives too. That Eerie Impulse is so important to make sure that the Zamazenta actually stuck around.
That would have been so much more impactful if Justin had opted to target that Maridon with the Body Press, though. Now that the Discharge did like slightly over half of Zamazenta's remaining HP, I think even one more Eerie Impulse wouldn't be able to protect it from that Discharge, which means that Iron Crown and Maridon should be able to both attack this turn. And Discharge can pick off Zamazenta, do some damage with Thunderous. Iron Crown can then swing at Thunderous as well. Both at minus two, maybe Thunderous sticks around one more turn, but this is actually a much more strong spot for Ryli now, because even though his Pokemon are threatened by that Eerie Impulse, both being special attackers, Justin doesn't have a great chance to attack right now thanks to the Tailwind from Whimsicott.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's also going to be Choice Specs too that helps to just boost up some of that damage. So you're mitigating it even just a little bit with just that item choice. This Thunder is still sticking around, means that it can land an Eerie Impulse into this Iron Crown. So that damage is going to be limited in just a little bit. But see that Ground Terror coming in clutch. And the Zamazenta cannot withstand another discharge from that Maraidon. So finally, how many turns into this game are we? And the Zamazenta is just knocked out.
And how many Eerie Impulses has this Thunderous used? I think it's been on the turn for on the field for maybe 6 or 7 turns, and all but once has Eerie Impulse. So a lot of special attack drops coming through here. But finally KO'd, and Riley has the option to switch out one of his two Pokemon, reset those special attack drops, and try to get some big damage going later on in this game. This Ground Terror has been really cool because not only is it great offensively, you know, Steel and Psychic have a hard time hitting opposing Steel types, and Ground gives you something to do that. Also scares away some Fire types you might be seeing along the way, but also it allows you to discharge next to your Iron Crown, not worry about damaging it, not worrying about paralyzing it, and it gives you so much more flexibility here on this Choice Specsman Maraidon team.
Well, that Eerie Impulse is definitely gonna hurt now because this Maraidon did just lose access to electric terrain, so this Hadron engine has been shut down for now, unless Riley Vectura wants to actually switch this Maraidon off the field and bring the Whimsicott in, which is still full health.
Yes. Importantly, though, the Maraidon is pretty low, and one Sucker Punch from this Chan Pao should be able to KO it. Grassy Glide, maybe not, just because it still does resist those Grass-type moves with that Dragon-typing. But Iron Crown now is facing the detriments of becoming a Ground-type, as it now becomes weak to this Rillaboom's Grass-type attacks. With that Miracle Seed item that we're seeing on the Rillaboom, those Grass-type attacks will be even further boosted in terms of their damage, which is a really big deal for this Iron Crown.
Maraidon, though, might be the last bastion for this game one for Riley. So it goes back into its Pokeball and Whimsicott with that Focus Sash, able to withstand this Icicle Crash that comes into that slot instead. The Tachyon Cutter, though, it's gonna be a double hit from this move and a knockout onto this Chien Pao. Nice way to bypass that Focus Sash and just get a clean KO.
That's exactly why you would still run Tachyon Cutter on the Iron Crown instead of something like Flash Cannon. Flash Cannon is 100% accurate, it will never miss, but Tachyon Cutter allows you to KO Chien Pao through that Focus Sash, which is a really big deal now. The Maraidon can come back in, reset the electric terrain, and make sure that the Grassy Glide from this Rillaboom will not be doing super effective damage. You've also reset your special attack drops. Iron Crown still is at -2 and was able to KO the Chien Pao through that, which is really impressive. But we have the Maraidon hitting the field once again with some very strong Dragon Pulses at its disposal. And again, you can't miss Dragon Pulse now, which is great, especially because this Rillaboom is not a Salt Vest. You don't even really need Dracometeer at this point.
No. I think so. I think you're just super happy to know that you have the damage multipliers from Hadron Engine and just the general same type attack bonus being a Dragon type feels pretty good. And the Tachyon Cutter is able to go first. Rillaboom is still pretty tanky, but the critical hit is potentially just going to seal the deal here for this Rillaboom as the Maraidon goes for the Dragon Pulse and plenty of damage now to pick up that knockout and get Riley the win in game number one.
If there was any question before, that critical hit on the second Tachyon Cutter hit really sealed the deal. I think it was probably over in Riley's favor regardless, just based on how that damage was coming through.
But I wanted to know.
I know. And it would have been good for Justin to know too, right? You know, is Dragon Pulse enough from just over half HP without the terrain? But we did see an interesting speed interaction there too. The Iron Crown on Riley's end was attacking before the Maraidon, which probably gives away that Maraidon isn't trained to be as fast as naturally possible. Could come in very handy for Justin to know because Maraidon and Chien Pao both have the same speed. If Justin's Chien Pao is trained to be as fast as possible, it should always attack before Maraidon without any kind of speed control.
Let's go back and look at the highlights for this game number one.
Yeah. Justin is a very animated player.
He really is, though. I love watching him play because he always, like, is in the zone. He's a great player and also shows so much emotion.
Yeah. Oh, you know what? I just realized something. The Iron Crown was a -2 special attack when the electric terrain got set up again.
So it got a speed boost.
So it got a speed boost from Quark Drive.
Yeah.
So maybe it isn't actually faster than Maraidon.
I don't think so.
Probably not.
I would assume not. But it was still a cool interaction to see.
It is,
something to consider as well.
And it's good to know, because the way that the Quark Drive and Protosynthesis abilities work, it just takes whatever the highest stat is at the time, not necessarily like before any items or like stat drops or anything. And so if Riley does take another Eerie Impulse on that Iron Crown, that actually could come in handy. Like maybe you need to outspeed, you know, something like the Zamazenta or even like the Choice Scarf Urshifu, actually. That could actually be a really big deal if you're able to outspeed that with your Iron Crown.
I mean, you outsped a Qianpao, which is at the same natural speed as a Maraidon.
Yeah, good
point. So that really did come in handy to be able to get the outspeed to get the Tachyon Cutter.
You have to wonder if Justin realized that too, right?
It's not something.
Yeah, I know. It didn't until just right after thinking about how that could have happened.
I stopped paying attention to it because I was like, oh, surely it just gets a special attack boost because it's an Iron Crown.
Like, and maybe like Tailwind was up or something. It didn't hit me until it acted before the Maraidon.
And I was like, I don't think that that's possible.
Right.
Like, I don't know if it's mathematically possible, but then we have booster energies that come in play. You know what? Things get funky.
They sure do.
A little bit funkier right now, shall we? As we've got Riley and Justin in this game number two, with Riley leading the Maraidon and the Incineroar, and Zamazenta Thunderous once again for Justin.
That Covert Cloak going to come in really handy here because, again, Incineroar cannot fake out this Thunderous because of Cloak. And so the minus two special attack from the Maraidon is a very real possibility. Eerie Impulse here could be a great way to prevent that Maraidon's damage. We saw Body Press from Zamazenta actually not KO Incineroar with only the plus one defense boost, so that actually might give away this Incineroar is trained to be very, very bulky. Makes sense with the Assault Vest. Sometimes players have been opting for a very fast Incineroar, but Riley in this case saying, I don't really need that.
Maybe not. This Thunderous was such a problem though for Riley. It extended the game so much longer and kind of forced Riley to have to make a lot of adjustments in order to just shed all of this drop. So you have to imagine that he's coming into this game number two, anticipating that it's going to be a strategy that Justin would want to lean on. But it's going to be a fake out into the Zamazenta, at least for now, as the Eerie Impulse moves first right after that. So Maraidon not necessarily going to be able to deal out just as much damage, but you see the Bolt switch. Another great play by Riley to anticipate that Eerie Impulse coming through.
I feel like when people are running Choice Mix Maraidon, Bolt Switch is the move they use 90% of the time, right? Like, it's such a great tool for positioning. But not only that, it does so much damage under some circumstances. Not in this one, obviously. Minus two, facing a grass-type Zamazenta that is naturally very bulky and now resists your electro-type attacks. And now, in a decent spot again, the Zamazenta able to go for something like a big body press into that Incineroar. Probably not knock it out, but you could possibly get an assist from your Thunderous's Thunderbolt. And you still, of course, have the Eerie Impulse support to lower the damage from this Whimsicott Moonblast if you need to.
I think it's just an easy Tailwind setup, though.
You really want that Tailwind because that helps a lot. It helps you fight the possible, you know, Thunder Waves from this Thunderous. It helps you outspeed the possible Qianpao that's in the back for Justin after one of these two Pokemon gets knocked out or switches out. And of course, that is kind of the main thing Whimsicott is there for, the Prankster Tailwind, which we do see get set up by Riley.
Why? It was on our caster predictions all along.
Exactly.
But the Body Press now into the Incineroar.
It is
just a one-hit knockout. I mean, it was intimidated. Gotta remember, it was Intimidate on the last one, and maybe just a roll.
It was, but Body Press is actually not affected by Intimidate because it is using the defense stat. So it might actually just be a damage roll into that Incineroar.
Yeah.
That's kind of rough, I think, for Justin in that first game. Maybe that was kind of a game changer, not having that Incineroar dispatched earlier on. But for Riley now, loses the Incineroar before it can attack. Again, seeing that Incineroar does not attack before the Zamazenta and Tailwind. And importantly, breaking the Focus Sash on Whimsicott with the Thunderbolt. I think that's a really smart play from Justin because now you won't only need one Heavy Slam, you know, one strong attack from this Qianpao to get rid of this Whimsicott, whereas before it held onto that Focus Sash for a long time into the first game.
But Justin's in a pretty good position right now too, outside of even just having broken the Focus Sash. You still have those options in the pack, and now that this Zamazenta is also that Grass Terra, you just have a great way to be able to resist kind of all of the damage that this Maraidon could be throwing at you unless you wanted to lean into specifically the Dragon Pulse.
Yes, exactly. The Dragon Pulse is the only thing that can hit this Zamazenta for neutral damage, but if you're using Maraidon in electric terrain, I think you want to be using those electric type attacks as much as humanly possible.
But that's where this Rillaboom can really come in and throw a wrench into the works, because you're resetting the terrain now, so you've got that grass back in your control, but Riley's been able to play around this so well. Either just kind of continuing to use Fold Switch here to get this Maraidon off the field, or making sure that there is an opportunity later to be able to actually reset the terrain for yourself. But staying in for now, because it's going to get that Terra.
And it is a
Ghost Terra. It is. So no Electric Terra to boost up these attacks even further. It's just going to be able to deal with the body presses. And the encore here from Riley. Exactly. You're locking it into having to do a body press instead of something else like a heavy slam. As the Electro drift into the Rillaboom, like, wow. That's still so much damage on top of that, even knowing that that is a grass type and there's no electric terrain.
I love that play so much. Ghost type Terra Omnoridon is certainly not the most common. Most trainers running the choice specs opt for that electric Terra to further boost the attack of that Maridon, except now we have the Ghost type, which is a very defensive typing that a lot of trainers opt to use to be immune to fighting a normal type attacks. Comes in very handy here, because encoring Zamazenta into body press means it cannot damage this Maridon. I didn't actually see what Justin tried to do, but if he was opting to go for a heavy slam into Whimsicott the prior turn, encoring into body slam randomizes the target, or sorry, body press randomizes the target. So maybe even getting slightly unlucky there with the body press going straight into that Ghost type Maridon. Now you only have the option to do resisted body press into Whimsicott or immune body press into Maridon, which almost forces Justin to swap it out, which will, again, clear out that defense boost, and Justin will no longer have access to it for the remainder of the game.
Well, you still get access to some neutral damage if you are Justin. You get to go for grass type attacks into the Iron Crown. There's no ghost type, and
no
you
switches,
also
though.
Are able to actually hit into the Iron Crown that is now switched onto the field. So, Grassy Glide is able to connect there, and we are gonna see a body press head right in that Whimsicott's direction into the Protect.
Just wanted to get more damage with that body press. I think you have to respect that. Maybe probably a 2-hit KO into the Whimsicott there. Yeah, Zamazenta known for having a very, very big defense stat. And even the resisted body press could do a bunch of damage. But Rillaboom going for a Grassy Glide, get some nice chip damage into Iron Crown. Unfortunately for Justin, the Rillaboom does not have access to any moves that are not grass type moves. It is running Protect over a possible U-turn or even like a high horsepower for some coverage. So this Iron Crown now in a very strong position. Do have to worry about the body presses, but you know that the Zamazenta has Terastalized. It will be neutral into that Tachyon Cutter now, which our lovely host David did correct me in between games, is 100% accurate. Not just 100%, is infinite. Like, it just doesn't
miss.
It bypasses
right. Accuracy checks.
So it's a very Riley move then in that case.
Yes. I was going to say, Riley would never run an accurate move. I don't know, like, if we know our player well enough, but no music and no inaccurate moves. Just pure bliss. For Hydon. Now, resetting the electric terrain for itself, but Justin's one step ahead, wants to remove the Rillaboom as well. And the Thunderous now re-hitting the field to land the Eerie Impulses once again.
A great swap because it will resist that Tachyon Cutter and, of course, allow you to go for something like Eerie Impulse into that Maridon or even Iron Crown. It's useful damage there. And another big body press into Whimsicott. Again, would be a 2-hit KO there. And Encore does end. So now Riley has to choose what he wants to do with his Whimsicott. Do you want to possibly get another Tailwind up, save it for later? Do you want to Encore into body press again to lock it out from damaging the Maridon? But if you do that, you probably lose the Whimsicott to a body press. And now you're down to your final two Pokemon, both of which are vulnerable to Eerie Impulses.
It's too bad that the Whimsicott missed the Encore onto the Rillaboom. You would have loved to be able to lock it into a Grassy Glide, and it would have felt
terrain,
like that Whimsicott
yeah.
would have been able to give a little bit more value in that scenario. But you're right, there is a choice that Riley has to make in this upcoming turn, and it's just going to be a Protect.
Protect coming through from Whimsicott does not want to be knocked out by a body press this turn. Eerie Impulse, though, comes through into the Maridon, will lower its special attack back down to -2, and will be cutting its damage output. But Volt Switch immediately coming through again will be able to reset to bring the Iron Crown back onto the field.
Always the Volt Switch.
And again, it's just like it's such a safe move, right?
No, it is. Reposition. It is.
Got some damage at the same time.
It's very good. So we got the Iron Crown now. See, special attack this time around. No Eerie Impulses here. But the body press, still not able to actually pick up the knockout onto this Whimsicott. But you're kind of hoping that, like, maybe Whimsicott's able to provide value in a different way. So Iron Crown is still going to be pretty naturally speedy versus the other things that are here. Although the Zamazenta, I say that. But it's like, quite fast.
It is naturally pretty fast. Often not trained to be super fast, so it relies kind of on that natural speed. And so a Pokemon like Iron Crown with a bunch of training and speed might be able to attack before Zamazenta, but I'm not sure that speed interaction matters too much here. Neither of them are going to be knocking each other out on this turn. It kind of just gives you info for later on when that might come into play. Maybe when both of them are at much lower health and in range for a KO from something like Body Press or Tachyon Cutter.
Well, we don't get to see the knockout right now because it is just going to be Maraidon. I mean, this feels so risky in some senses that the Whimsicott's going to leave the field and the Maraidon is going to take its place. The Eerie Impulse, it's just the target's right in front of you with that Iron Crown. To be able to hit it there and the heavy slam into the Maraidon instead. Not too bad as the psychic noise, like that's just not doing nearly enough now after that Eerie Impulse.
Especially considering the Maraidon took that heavy slam pretty well, thanks to an Intimidator 2 from that Incineroar. Not in a super bad spot at all, but one thing to note is that now Maraidon is no longer an electric type. It can be paralyzed by Thunder Wave. If Justin wants to make it paralyzed, make sure that you're possibly outspeeding it even in Tailwind with your own Chien Pao, that could be a really powerful option here. And even if it switches out into Whimsicott, that means your Thunderous is faster than it, and you could taunt it before the Whimsicott could go for something like an Encore or a Tailwind to get that speed up later on.
Great point. Really great point, because Justin still hasn't revealed that fourth and final Pokemon to Riley yet.
True.
But based on what we saw in that game number one, pretty good reasoning behind what could be in that final slot. Eerie Impulse again, this Maraidon just like can't catch a break with any of this. So the Volt Switch, though, a KO.
Finally.
Big KO, really, because now the Eerie Impulser is off the field, and so the Maraidon gets to come back in, and no, it's not going to get any drops, and it's not going to get paralyzed.
Yep, no speed control left on the field for Justin as Thunderous is finally knocked out. But what this Zamazenta does is a big deal. Body Press and Iron Crown, almost enough for a KO, but just barely hangs on. Minus two Psychic Noise, though, really doesn't do too much damage to this Zamazenta, which is still sitting pretty. However, the Eerie Impulse is also no longer an option. If Iron Crown swaps out, that means that Riley's two very strong special attackers will be at neutral special attack for the rest of the game.
Chien Pao, with the Eerie Impulse, actually, is it still a two-hit knockout with the Attacking Cutter?
It might be, but at this point, you have to worry about Sucker Punch, right? The Whimsicott is in range for one Body Press or Heavy Slam from Zamazenta, and Iron Crown gets knocked out by Sucker Punch from here. Maraidon now being a Ghost type, now weak to Sucker Punch. I don't think either of Riley's attackers can Sucker Punch or can attack for the rest of the game as long as Chien Pao is there to Sucker Punch. And you also you can't just protect Iron Crown and try and throw two Moonblasts into the Chien Pao if you're Riley, because Justin could just Heavy Slam that slot and Whimsicott gets knocked out.
Yep.
This is a pretty dire situation for Riley right now because Sucker Punch is such a big threat.
Well, this is one way to bypass that, right? Is just switch the Maraidon in and hope that it wasn't actually a Sucker Punch selected in that slot, or maybe hope that that is what it is.
I mean, even if it is a Sucker Punch, right, the Sucker Punch will fail into the switching and protecting two slots on Riley's side. But this is kind of just the same situation we were in the prior turn, right? You have a strong Pokemon that will be knocked out by Sucker Punch next to this Whimsicott that can't take an attack from Zamazenta at this point. And especially switching in the Maraidon as the electric terrain runs out. Really rough spot for Riley here because, again, you just can't attack with Maraidon if Sucker Punch is coming through.
Yeah. Yeah, it's definitely very tough. But there's also another move that this Chien Pao has access to. If you don't want to play the mind game of going for the Sucker Punch, then you could potentially just go for the Throat Chop instead.
True.
If you expect that this Maraidon is going to switch out and that Iron Crown is going to take its place, you're going to get a knockout regardless.
Very true. And you can't knock out the Chien Pao before the Whimsicott can attack as well, because Whimsicott is slower than Chien Pao. You could double into it with something like the Electro Drift or Volt Switch and the Moonblast. But the Chien Pao will be able to take one KO regardless. It's really just a matter of if Sucker Punch comes through here, and it does. Maraidon will be knocked out.
It is, and that means that this is going to be such a big source of damage removed here from Riley. And all you have left is the opportunity of this Iron Crown to try to bring it back. But this Moonblast, at least it's able to help with this Chien Pao, but not before this final Body Press from this Zamazenta is going to come through and get the knockout onto the Whimsicott as well. This has been a close set through and through, but it's just the Iron Crown with a sliver of HP for Riley, and it's got two, three Pokemon to work through.
This is certainly not enough for Riley to take this game. Really well played by Justin, chipping those Pokemon down into that Sucker Punch range. And of course, forcing that Ghost Terra out from the Maraidon really helps out, because at that point, you don't care about speed control anymore. Tailwind going up means nothing. Losing your Thunder Wave means nothing. When Sucker Punch is super effective from Chien Pao, 9 times out of 10, I'd say you're getting knocked out by it. There are very few things weak to Sucker Punch from Chien Pao that can survive one. And so unfortunately, Maraidon and Iron Crown are not two of them.
Amazing. Now though, if you're Riley, how do you adjust to this? Because it's been the same lead, it's been the same four for Justin this entire set so far. You have the Eerie Impulsor and the Thunderous. Is that something that you give a little bit more respect to, try to knock it out earlier?
Well, the thing is, looking at Riley's team, the other options that we haven't seen are Ursaluna Blood Moon, which also just gets Eerie Impulse ad nauseum, and then Urshifu Rapid Strike. He's holding the Mystic Water item, but that's a kind of a really tough thing to bring into Zamazenta because it is so strong on the defense side. You can critical hit through it with Surging Strikes, but seeing that Justin is so willing to go for that Grass Terra, it's a very strong Pokemon into Urshifu Rapid Strike. And of course, there's a Rillaboom there to make its life difficult as well. Justin's team, looking at the other two that haven't been brought, also an Urshifu and a Pelipper, two water types into a Maridon, which might be very difficult to bring. And so I kind of see these same four Pokemon coming on both sides, but maybe the players opt to play them slightly differently. That Ground Terra from Iron Crown was very valuable for Riley in that first game because it gave him so much space to go for those discharges. If you're not bringing the Ursaluna Blood Moon, which I think makes sense into Justin's team, you don't have anything naturally that can take a discharge on your team.
I say do it. I mean, the reason why Riley was able, one of the reasons why Riley won that game number one is because of the Ground Tier Iron Crown.
Right. It gave him so much defensive flexibility with that discharge, but also unlocked the ground type Terra Blast, which is a really valuable tool into that Zamazenta before it terrestrializes itself.
I think you can always expect in this matchup, though, that Justin's going to Terra the Zamazenta. I don't think there's
a whole lot
of reason not to when you're. The only thing that's really threatening you is really the Incineroar.
And that's where the Dragon Pulse versus Draco Meteor comes into play too, is once that Zamazenta terrestrializes and the Dragon move is the one that's neutral instead of the Electric moves, only having access to Dragon Pulse, which won't be boosted by terrain even further than the Hadron Engine boost, it's not going to be doing too much damage, especially once you start factoring in those Eerie Impulses as well.
Oh, this poor Whimsicott. Like, you just get flattened. Even if, I know body press, like, it takes the defensive step of the Zamazenta, but also, like, could you imagine if it was also weight-based?
Yeah, body press, heavy slam combo.
I know.
It's like a duo move.
Right.
Didn't they do that in some of the contests in the Sinnoh animation?
I think so.
That'd be kind of fun.
Yeah, exactly. But let's get the run back as we enter into game number three. Between Riley and Justin, tied one apiece. Justin running the same leads back, and Riley with the Iron Crown and the Maridon, going back to the game plan from game number one almost.
I kind of like this lead from Riley. It is two very strong special attackers on the field at once, and unfortunately for Justin, you can only Eerie Impulse one of them at a time. If you do opt to, let's say, double target this Thunderous with, you know, the Psychic Noise and an Electro Drift or something like that, two very strong attacks, that means that you're forcing Justin to kind of pick one to Eerie Impulse, and the other gets a full power swing into that Thunderous with the electric terrain boost.
Makes a lot of sense, though, I think, to go after the Maridon, just because you've got to do something. Like, literally anything about the fact that it's still on electric terrain, and you don't want to risk just bringing your Rillaboom in. So I think the Eerie Impulse into that slot is probably the priority here. But it's terrestrialization on both sides. Grass Terra for the Zamazenta, then Ghost Terra once again for Maridon.
The Grass Terra really helps against Maridon. You're resisting those strong electric type attacks, but it's not too great into Iron Crown because you do kind of unlock the ability to go for Tachyon Cutter into that slot. Protect coming through from Iron Crown, though, no Tachyon Cutters this turn as Eerie Impulse hits the correct target. The Maridon will now be at -2 special attack, and whenever an attack it chooses to use here, the Dragon Pulse calling the terrestrialization. A really great play, but an also good play from Justin because body press, well, it doesn't hit the non-ghost type target, but the Eerie Impulse was the big deal there.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the Zamazenta takes that pretty comfortably. I think it could still take two more realistically before potentially getting knocked out. Depends on the damage rolls, of course, but that feels good for Justin to be able to have the Zamazenta not take too much damage.
And if we're in the same position as last game too now, where the ghost type Maridon is on the field, it can be hit with Thunder Wave. The Iron Crown cannot turn into a ground type, so it will always be vulnerable to Thunder Wave as well. Eerie Impulse, the move of choice there. Both of these strong special attackers now being neutered.
That's going to be great news here for Justin, but another Dragon Pulse here. Still looks like it could be close. Body press in response brings his Iron Crown down so low, but it's just going to go for the Psychic Noise into the Zamazenta. That means one more attack from this Maridon will be plenty to knock it out, but it still potentially have to take another Eerie Impulse before it does that.
It can, and also there's still the Thunder Wave play. If Thunder Wave goes into the Maridon, it will be paralyzed, have its speed halved, and we saw the Zamazenta act before Iron Crown. Not gonna happen this turn though, because Justin opts to swap out Azamazenta, keep it safe for another day. Rillaboom hits the field and will cancel out that electric terrain.
Yeah, so another way to limit the damage output of this Maraidon. One thing though about that Azamazenta, doesn't get that defense boost back. So as you called out in that game number one, we actually get the chance to see it play out because it's still alive in this game three and switching off the field. The Dragon Pulse to cover for that switch.
That's, I mean, still so much.
Nothing wants to come into that slot. Like, everything takes neutral damage to that.
Nice play there with the Thunderbolt. You get some damage onto Maraidon. One more Eerie Impulse. You start to kind of hit some diminishing returns there, and Iron Crown protecting means that if you would try to fire a Thunderbolt into that slot, it would have failed. Not done any damage at all. So Justin still makes some ground with that Thunderbolt into Maraidon. Possibly puts Maraidon in range for an attack from this Rillaboom. Maybe Woodhammer's not enough to one-hit KO it at full HP, but now it's certainly in range, I'd imagine, with the grassy terrain and the Miracle Seed boost. And of course, Iron Crown still vulnerable to something like a Thunderbolt from the Thunderous. It did just protect, so it has the possibility to be faked out on this turn from Rillaboom as well.
It does, but it's just going to be the Incineroar. So a good way to cover for this, which we kind of get a chance to maybe see what that play was that you were talking about pay off here. It would have, though, if it wasn't Incineroar switching in as a dark type. So it's not going to be affected by this prankster Thunder Wave. So unfortunately, not going to get those speed drops that Justin was hoping for. But the Rillaboom wanted to be able to follow that up into the Maraidon with this Woodhammer. Incineroar, the perfect choice to bring in, not even just to lower the attack output of this Rillaboom by one stage, but also just take that Woodhammer.
And of course, no Thunder Wave coming through there means that Iron Crown and Incineroar are still on the field. Iron Crown actually very much benefiting from the grassy terrain that Justin set up. We were in a position where one Thunderbolt might have been able to knock it out, but from this range, I think those couple turns of grassy terrain recovery have put it such that it can no longer be knocked out by one Thunderbolt. You have to target it with something else or with both Pokemon at the same time. And now that Incineroar has hit the field, it's in such a strong position, able to eat up that Thunder Wave and with immunity because it is a dark type and prankster moves do not work. And of course, now you threaten with a fake out into Rillaboom or even a strong attack like a knockoff or a Flare Blitz.
Yeah, so Rillaboom just protecting. That is kind of one of the nice benefits of being able to hold a different item to what we usually see on the Rillaboom, like an Assault Vest, that you do get access to protect. So kind of nice there. But the U-turn from the Incineroar, having Assault Vest means that you do have access to a couple more coverage options than we would usually see on an Incineroar. And on a team like this, when you also have Volt Switch available from the Maraidon, it's a great way to get that Incineroar in as your defensive switch and out again so that you can get this Maraidon to have that terrain control.
Terrain control back up means that the speed on Iron Crown will now be activated by the Quark Drive.
Yeah, there we go.
Which actually might be a big deal if the Azamazenta comes back in. It was pretty low on HP. Even though Iron Crown is a minus two special attack, it might still be able to get a KO into it thanks to that speed boost now able to act before the Azamazenta. And of course, the Rillaboom still at low HP, but the electric terrain coming back up means that Grassy Glide is no longer a priority move. You will have to switch it out if you want these terrain control in your favor again. And you also still have Eerie Impulse control. You have some Thunder Wave options here.
Eerie Impulse now lowers that Maraidon's attack again, but I feel like the important thing is just trying to get the knockout here. But because this Iron Crown does have that speed, and you can't go for the priority Grassy Glides either, this Rillaboom gets knocked out before it's able to go for a big Woodhammer.
It
so huge, huge knockout with that speed boost.
It really is, and now Maraidon has the option to go for a Volt Switch here. It did not get paralyzed, thankfully, so it has the option to come back in, still be at full speed, and of course reset all these Eerie Impulse drops. Even though we have seen so many Eerie Impulses coming out from this Thunderous, so many of them just haven't stuck because Riley is very willing to switch out his Pokemon, either with the pivot moves like Volt Switch, or just hard switching into something else like this Incineroar.
Ooh, what a tough call to make, though. This Tian Pao, the fourth and final for Justin, finally makes an appearance in this game. But Riley actually has yet to reveal what that fourth one is.
That's true. It might be that Whimsicott, but I think at this point, you'd imagine
how
Whimsicott
the tables have turned.
Probably hits the field sooner, typically, when you're using Whimsicott to get that speed control.
Exactly.
So it could be something like that Urshifu to get some more damage. Even the Ursaluna Blood Moon, if the Thunderous is the last thing remaining for Justin, then Ursaluna just comes in and can't take damage from it at all. So that might explain why Riley's been much more keen to target the things next to the Thunderous, not having to worry about Thunderous with that Blood Moon later on. This Chan Pao now does have its Focus Sash intact, Iron Crown, Shirley, and Sucker Punch range. And of course, like we mentioned, Maridon, being a ghost type, is very vulnerable to that Sucker Punch. So if Riley doesn't have a way to deal with this Chan Pao before it can fire these Sucker Punches off, he might still be in a rough position.
Well, the Protect is going to deny one Sucker Punch here, so Chan Pao not able to actually do any damage into the Iron Crown. But we have finally get a chance to see Thunderous do something a little bit different. Thunderbolt just chipping away at this Incineroar as the Flare Blitz into that slot. What a great pickup of a KO. Maybe it isn't that Blood Moon that could be in the back there. Even you might want to consider that you take out the Chan Pao instead because it would be packing an Icicle Crash.
I think even if it is that Blood Moon, I like that play a lot too because thanks to the speed boost and Quark Drive, your Iron Crown is the fastest thing on the field. You've now removed the Eerie Impulse threat, which has been really an obnoxious like part of Justin's team for Riley in this match. And now your Iron Crown, I think even at -2 special attack we saw in a previous game, is able to KO Chan Pao through the Focus Sash. And so you have to worry about Iron Crown. Even though it's at -2 special attack, you can't just leave it alone because it is able to take this KO, which means that Justin has to split his attention between the two Pokemon on Riley's side of the field instead of taking an easier route and, you know, maybe focusing on one thing because the other Pokemon is a little bit crippled.
Covering for the option, though, that this Ghost-type Maridon could switch back in, not wanting to go for the body press. So you're able to at least do a little bit of damage knowing that, yeah, that is actually what happened here. But the Sucker Punch, big KO onto the Iron Crown. And that's going to be a huge Pokemon, very speedy. Now, Riley can't get access to that.
Smart Heavy Slam, too. There is no loss of damage into this Maridon because the Incineroar swapped out into the Ghost type. Really nice play for Justin to cover the possibility of that Pokemon becoming a Ghost type in front of that Zamazenta and no body press whiffing into it. That means that Maridon is now certainly in Sucker Punch range, even though it might get intimidated later on. But Urshifu comes in. This is a Choice Scarf Urshifu. No, it's Mystic Water. Justin has a Choice Scarf one. So Mystic Water Urshifu comes in, and that means that Justin has speed advantage. If Maridon stays on the field and attacks, it will get Sucker Punched. Zamazenta, though, does not have a defense boost. Body Press, unlikely to do a huge chunk of damage to it. I don't know if a combination of Sacred Sword and Body Press. No, it's not even Sacred Sword. This Urshifu like really can't touch this Chan Pao at all, Nurse Mary.
No, it's gonna be a tough one, I think.
Yeah.
For the Urshifu, I mean, I think the only thing that I would think about is just the fact that maybe you even just go for the close combat.
You can close combat. The issue is I don't know that Justin has a way to damage this Urshifu anymore. The Surging Strikes is enough to KO through this Focus Sash often. And even this Volt Switch comes out before the Chan Pao can attack. These two Pokemon are at their neutral speed states, and that might have possibly been a speed tie.
I mean, they've taken off the headsets already. I think they know Maridon is just going to end up taking the pivot. They're shaking hands already. So the job has been done.
Even though the game isn't technically ended yet, I think they both realize that that is a pretty clear win for Riley in this state, just because that Volt Switch meant that the Zamazenta got knocked out before the Chan Pao could attack Maridon. Justin opting not to go for Sucker Punch there, possibly trying to catch